I had the pleasure to talk already in 2016. 2016, if you remember that, we talked about consumer trends. We talked also a lot how we reduce salt, sugar, and fat in our products. What are the technologies we can use here? And then finally, towards the end of the talk, we talked about plant-based nutrition, which is now exploding. And we will also discuss that briefly during the upcoming talk. Now for today, I have chosen the topic, the future of food. Very broad topic, everything we do is fitting in it. I was forced to give the title so early, I said, okay, I take a broader topic, and then I have freedom of choice what I pack into this topic. Now, I will talk about the changing value perception of consumers, because we saw in the last couple of years significant changes how consumers perceive the value of food. Then we will talk also about how we can, about food ideologies. Because, you know, and you're pretty much aware, there's an explosion of different dietary patterns. And probably many of you have already by now a vegetarian or a vegan in the family. At least I have three of them. And I'm the only carnivore or the person who is eating still a bit meat in the family. And that's causing a lot of challenges, but also a lot of opportunities in the food space. Then we will talk about how to bring health benefits into food, into the offer. And we will finish then finally with personalized nutrition. And if we have time, we will talk a bit about how digital technologies are shaping here the food business. So that's the menu. So let's dive into it. So let me start with global trends which are shaping the food supply and demand. And you're all aware of them. We have environmental trends. Global warming only be one of those. Then we have demographic trends. We have the increase of the world population, but we have also inequality in income distribution. We have consumer trends, which are then leading to the mentioned ideologies. And we have technological trends. And finally, there are also business trends because we see some dramatic changes happening in the business. We see, in fact, the fragmentation of the business. We see many small startups. And food is somehow getting cool. You see that in food blogs. You see that also in TV. Food is a very, very attractive topic. And that leads to a number of changes. Let me see. Yeah. On one hand, the quantity and quality of agricultural production will change, and is already changing. Manufacturing systems are changing, global calorie and nutrition demand is changing, and the consumer value, or what the consumer perceives as value, is changing quite a bit. And we'll come in the next slide to this topic. The point of sale and consumption is changing. Food is now available anywhere. You can find it everywhere. You can find it in offices, in trains, Uber Eats. You can sit in a park and you can have a drone delivering you an ice cream. So in the States, we have, for instance, some pilots ongoing here. Then the competitive landscape is changing. You see many small companies emerging. And then finally, we have the retail systems and the supply systems, which are also changing. E-commerce playing here a major role. So let's talk about the value perception of consumers. Yes, what's perceived by consumers, thank you very much, as value? Well, we have some value components which we consider as a base. Safety, clear, that's expected by any food product which is on the market, and affordability. Now let me make a point about affordability. This is getting increasingly important. As a matter of fact, you have still many people in low-income countries, but even people here in Central of Europe and Switzerland, which have decreasing income, and here affordability is getting really an important feature. If you have only $1 in the pocket to nourish a whole family of 8 people a day, and there are many people, for instance, in sub-Saharan Africa, which are living from $1 a day, then it's getting very tough. And here, technology and also the food industry has to make much more efforts to nourish as well those people. Sensorial appeal was always there. There's nothing new. High nutritional value, clean label as well. And now the component of minimal environmental impact and footprint. And this is pretty new. When I was talking here 2016, I have not mentioned plastic. I have not mentioned greenhouse gas emissions. And now this is consuming a lot of my own time, 20-30% probably of my own time, which is massive. And consumers expect it. So it's now getting a part of the base offering, a part of the base value perception. It's a fundamental requirement for every food product which is on the market. And this can be then complemented with another couple of value elements. On one hand, novel excitement. I come in a minute to that. Variety. It's getting very, very important. And that's driven by social media. You see now many food bloggers, influencers, which are sharing cool food products. Here, the architecture and the color of a food product is playing a key role, because you cannot share over social media taste and aroma, right? So it has to look cool. It has to be a very exciting offering, something totally new. Sometimes you have category fusion, meaning you have food products from different categories which are merging into one new offering. Then natural was always high on the agenda, and it's still high on the agenda. Organic is enjoying growth. And then the aspect of authenticity. Here we can play as at least the big food manufacturers much better to bring authentic products to the market. I will talk briefly about that. Then food products suitable for different dietary patterns. And this is just an exploding universe. And you will see there are plenty of different dietary patterns. In the States, by the way, the number one and number two dietary pattern is intermittent fasting. So you have periods where you don't eat anything, 16 hours typically, to clean your body, and then you start again eating. And the number two pattern is the paleo diet. You wouldn't have guessed that, right? Paleolithic diet, so diet of the ancestors. Then we can also customize food for health. This is the fourth element. Personalized nutrition, getting increasingly traction. And then finally, medical nutrition, which was always there. So let's talk about novelty, excitement, variety, and like I said, very important for the young generation to share food, to have something cool to talk about. You see here food bloggers, which are sharing products in their blogs. You see Instagram, so we are talking about the Instagrammability of our offering in some categories. Confectionery, obviously, is a category which is very suitable to that. You see here KitKat, different KitKats, exciting forms of KitKat. You see red bean KitKat, a wasabi KitKat. You see a purple potato KitKat. And the newest one is a sake KitKat, which is my favorite. So fantastic products, fantastic excitement. And that leads as well to the continuous search for novelty. And that, together with the food ideologies, is leading finally to an appearance of new food categories. You see here, for instance, the grain-free pizza, where the dough is made entirely by cauliflower. So there is no flour, no wheat flour in this pizza. You see plant-based dairy products, alkaline water, and this is just a small selection. You see also here nitro coffee. It's a fusion of beer and coffee. So we have an offer which resembles a bit like a beer. If we talk now about authenticity, so this was novelty. Now let's switch to authenticity. We can relate that to different ingredients, recipes, and also processes. Ancient ingredients, simple recipes. You see here, for instance, the cocoa fruit KitKat. Here the chocolate is made 100% out of cocoa. So we take the cocoa beans and we sweeten the mass here with the cocoa pulp. So you valorize the entire cocoa fruit. It's very sustainable. It's delicious taste, slightly fruity, and it's creating a lot of excitement in the marketplace. It's not so easy to try this cocoa paste, and we have a patented technology in this respect. On the right-hand side, you see Monsoon Coffee. Here we are replicating the trajectory of coffee from India, from the Malabar coast, through Cape Horn back to Europe. So we're maturating the coffee in warehouses under different monsoon conditions in order to mimic this process. A quick word about ancient fruits and vegetables. Often, they are really much more nutritious. You see here some results from the literature. You see, for instance, on the left-hand side, if you take an old apple cultivar, it's much higher in polyphenols, much higher in ascorbic acid, and you know that if you bite in one of those old apples, they're getting brown. Over the years, we have breeded that away because it was for industry not desired, but we breeded away all the goodness of those fruits. Similar, here on the right-hand side, you see different grains, ancient grains, often much lower in gluten and much easier to digest for people which are sensitive to gluten. Food tribes, just an explosion. You see here just some I mentioned already. You see vegetarians, you see paleo, pagans, pescatarians, ketogenic people who eat no carbs, basically proteins and fats, lactose-free, dairy-free, chrononutrition, where you adapt your food intake basically to your inner clock. So really an explosion. And one segment which is growing currently very fast, where we have very good collaboration here with Bühler, is the vegan meat analog segment, where we try to develop products which mimic beef or meat in terms of texture, color, flavor, appearance. The red color is here achieved by red beet, which is non-GMO, but which is turning brown during heating. And the product is containing no cholesterol. It's very low in fat. So we try to achieve also a much better nutritional profile. And by the way, the greenhouse gas emissions is reduced by 90% compared to beef. Technology, not so easy. You have quite a sophisticated technology behind that. You see here, for instance, these are plant-based fibers, which are created here by wet extrusion. Those fibers are then cut down, and then they're glued together again with other fibers to create a texture like ground beef. And the elasticity of the product, which is expected by the consumers, is provided here often by wheat proteins. Equally, we can produce here a vegan cheese. You see here a cheese matrix. Resembles a bit like the strands of a cheese fondue, right? So we are pulled together here, we pulled apart the cheese. You see, you get a certain elasticity of the cheese. And this is a cheese which is made entirely out of dietary fibers, a gel network. And in yellow, you see a crystallized plant oil. Texture of those products is key, and it depends highly here on the structure we create during cooling. See on the right-hand side, during the cooling period, we increase the elasticity for cheese. You have to have an elastic behavior. Now let's talk about how we can bring health benefits into products. On one hand, we can use new ingredients. And you see here many products which are made with new ingredients. You see here, for instance, cannabidiol, which is an oil coming from the cannabis plant, enjoying a lot of popularity currently in many markets and legalized, for instance, in Canada. But you see also A2 milk, the ancient form of milk. You see superfruits, MCT oils, which are medium-chain triglyceride oils. And you see microalgae. And Alexander Mattis already talked about that, a very nutritious ingredient where we have a lot of expectations while going forward in our development work. We can also add probiotics, and then you get a range of different probiotic products. You get supplements. We can add here different bacteria. You see, for instance, bifidobacterium, lactococcus, lactobacilli. We can add also prebiotics, and if you combine both, we talk about symbiotics. So you have the right bacteria and the right fibers to nourish this bacteria. Ultimately, if you want to deliver heart benefits, we have to understand the link between nutrition and health along the different stages of life. It starts in the preconception phase, where we're talking about epigenetics, how food is really impacting here, how the DNA is read. Food is not changing our genes, but it's impacting which genes are activated and which genes are deactivated. Food is impacting how fast our neuronal system is developing, how fast our brain is developing, and food is also impacting the aging process. So we start already in the preconception phase to watch out what food does to the health of a baby. And then we look during pregnancy and we investigate how food is impacting then also the development of a child. We did big studies in this respect. Here, just one result in the middle, which is probably not a surprise, but which is lacking still solutions. children which are born by cesarean have a totally different microbiome. And considering the fact that in the US, for instance, 40% of the children are born by cesarean, we need to act a bit. We need to provide those children with the right microbiota. And on the right-hand side, you see that nutrition is impacting breast milk quality, but some women still cannot, even in a case of optimal nutrition, produce the right nutrient density in breast milk. Breast milk is still the best nutrient for the baby, but by nourishing the mother even better, we can do a lot of good for the baby. And you see here different products, solutions, which we brought already to the market, supplements for the prebiotic state. This is an interesting one. This is a product which is helping mothers to avoid here diabetes during pregnancy. And this is terrible for the child. If the blood sugar is too high in the serum of the mother, then the child is getting exposed already during pregnancy to very high blood sugar. And it's getting already imprinted and very sensitive for diabetes later in life, or has a very high risk. We also discovered that in many infant formulas, there are still some oligosaccharides, some carbohydrates missing, and that has dramatic impact on the microbiome of the baby. If those sugars are missing, the baby doesn't get the right microbiome, or is not developing the right microbiome. So we're adding now those sugars, which are illustrated here by the white and red structures, and while adding them, we favor the development of positive bacteria, bacteria which are beneficial in terms of health. You see here, these are the orange bacteria, bifidobacterium, and also some lactobacilli. On the other hand, we suppress the pathogenic bacteria, which are here illustrated in purple. These are, in principle, Salmonella and other pathogenic bacteria. Also very important how proper nutrition is impacting the development of the neuronal system of the child. We talk about myelination. This is the coats which are developing around the nerve cells. And the quicker this is going, the quicker the child is developing. And we found that if you have the right fatty acids in the product, this development is accelerated. Now, if we talk about aging, there are two mechanisms. Now, this was the first 1,000 days. Now, let's talk briefly about the aging population. Two mechanisms of aging. We start to understand now much better what's driving aging. On one hand, it's the DNA, which is damaged. This is pretty much known. But then there's a much more important mechanism, which is that the mitochondria, the power stations of the cell, they start to slow down. They lose their ability to produce energy for the aging body. You see here some of, this is a mitochondria cell, and you see some enzymatic complexes in the membrane of those mitochondria. And the activity of those complexes is slowing down. So the job is now, how can we reactivate these mitochondria cells? This is a mitochondria of a muscle cell. And you see here that during aging, many functionalities are lost and decreasing. You see, for instance, that the muscle strength is decreasing, so we are losing muscle mass. We have also gastric acid and immunity, which is decreasing, so the microbiota is changing. We see in aging population, for instance, clostridia emerging, which are very strong toxin producers. And we see that cognition and vision, this is obvious, is decreasing. For all those age-related diseases and health conditions, we can offer now solutions which are based on micronutrients. And the nice thing is, you can apply that equally to humans and animals. So we have also a big pet food business, and we apply the same solutions to both. And we have one very good example, which is a probiotic, which is calming down dogs. So if you have a dog which has digestive problems, barking a lot, you give him the probiotic, it's barking less, because it's less nervous. Now you give the same probiotic to humans, and we did some studies, you see that the prevalence of depressions is decreasing. So this is a probiotic which is working for humans and also for pets. This is the latest one. We have developed now, the first time, a cat food which is reducing the allergenicity of cats for the humans. So you feed your cat with this pet food, and the cat is getting less allergic for a human. We achieved that by adding to the cat food antibodies against the allergen. These are the blue antibodies. And they are complexing here the allergen in the cat. The cat is licking its fur, distributing these antibodies, and the allergenicity of the cat is decreasing. So it's the first ever. So it's a world novelty. It will come soon to the market. I'm sharing that already with you here up front. Let me finish with some words about digital nutrition, personalized nutrition, digital nutrition. So personalized nutrition is pretty much enabled here by digital tools. We can use DNA, serum biomarkers, intake data, questionnaires to personalize food. Probably the most reliable is serum biomarkers, DNA. There's still a lot of questions and discussions around how useful is DNA to predict nutritional needs of people. And then we can develop products. Sensor technology is helping us to advance here very quickly. So you have many non-invasive sensors to measure blood pressure, to measure blood glucose levels in the serum, and even alcohol levels in the serum, which is quite remarkable. Now, the question is always, is that then useful for humans? Do they change their behavior if they have these digital tools and they get personalized nutrition? And here, this is a plot from a Chinese cohort. We did a study in China together with Xiaomi, the biggest telecom provider in China. And we launched a nutritional app. So people on this app got nutritional advice. Vertical axis, you see diet diversity. Horizontal axis, duration of the app usage. You see, with increasing usage of the app, the diet diversity is increasing. In the meantime, we see also in purple, these are the young people. In green, these are more the aging people. The aging people stop a bit earlier. The young people continue to use the app, and eventually they change also their dietary pattern. Last but not least, we can also now personalize for pets. This is our pet food business, where we offer for small dogs different pet food than for large breeds. And you can enter the weight of your dog, the age of your dog, the breed, and we will here commission the right pet food just adapted to your dog. Last point, plastic waste, major issue. We all know that. I don't need to go into details. We have several solutions. On one hand, we try to avoid plastics by having bulk delivery systems. Then we simplify plastic packaging to make it easier recyclable, and we work on paper packaging. Here are a couple of examples of different paper packaging. And it's not so easy to provide the same barrier properties via paper packaging than we have with the plastic packaging. Plastic is there for a reason, to protect the product. Now you see here some new developments where we coated the paper with biodegradable material. This is very new. And I have big hopes that this is providing a very good solution to pack products. So you have a barrier layer, which is biodegradable, which is degrading during the paper recycling process. Biodegradable plastics, we can also use them pure. They are produced by microorganisms, and we have PHA, polyhydroxyalkanoate, which is the most promising one, which degrades even if in seawater in a couple of weeks or months, depending on the temperature of the seawater. You see here, for instance, a cup degrading in a compost. We have a collaboration here with Danimer Scientific. You see here some of the bacteria degrading the bioplastic, so they are transforming it into carbon dioxide and finally heat, energy. So this I skip. Digital is obviously changing a lot and impacting a lot our business. But let me come now to a summary. What are the challenges and what are the opportunities? On one hand, we have to continue to renovate our products based on the latest science to decrease the health-sensitive nutrients, but also increase positive or health-promoting nutrients. Then we have to adapt much better nutrition to the different stages of life. So there's an opportunity to segment our population even further. We can segment now according to sex, we can segment according to ethnics, we can segment according to age, we can segment now according to different parameters. highly affordable nutrition for low-income consumers very close to my heart. I think as an industry, and this is also a message to all of you, we have to do much more here to get really solutions which are truly affordable to the people in low-income countries where they are living for less than $1 a day. Innovating to address consumer trends, we have an acceleration of those trends, but then also the emerging of a large variety of food ideologies, which brings complexity to our business, but also plenty of opportunities. We just have to identify what are the trends and the ideologies which will stay. By the way, these ideologies, there's also big risk. The risk is that people getting deficient of certain nutrients. And you can imagine, if you are vegan, from where do you get vitamin B12 and iron? It's not an obvious one. And the prevalence of vitamin B12 and iron deficiency amongst the vegan population is very high. Now imagine, even mothers in this country here, if you have a vegan mother, 80% of the vegan mothers here in Switzerland or Germany are deficient in those nutrients. What's the effect on the children if they are pregnant, if they're getting children? So there is something to watch out, and we have to act on this one. Environmental footprint, we talked about plastics, but you know, a big, big problem which is ahead of us are also the greenhouse gas emissions, which are, in my mind, even more difficult to solve than the plastic issue. The plastic issue are getting now increasingly confident that we will solve that. Greenhouse gases is a much tougher one, because the greenhouse gases are going out there, and then every emission one person is creating is shared with the entire world population. So there's a lot of altruism which is needed, and a lot of activism from different players to solve the issue. And then, last but not least, responding changing economic framework. You have a risk that trade barriers are increasing, which is affecting all of us. You have these discussions, and you have a trade war currently going on. You have a progressing fragmentation of the industry. You might say, what's the issue there? Well, the issue is, if you have this fragmentation, how do you guard quality? How do you guard efficiency of production? How do you guard minimal environmental impact? So also not easy in this respect. And then finally, digital and e-commerce are changing rapidly the food value chain. So we have to address those challenges together as a community, but there are also ample opportunities. And we need to have new ways how we collaborate with each other. You saw here the cubic, which is fantastic. Congratulations to Bühler, really an inspiring element to further accelerate innovation. We are also building on our side now accelerators, and we are equipping all our centers to host startups and also teams from universities and suppliers. So in the future, we will see in our accelerator probably also some teams composed of Bühler and some of the companies represented here in the room. Having said that, thank you very much, and happy to answer questions.
So, ladies and gentlemen, I think it's mightily impressive to see how the world's biggest food company is utilizing science to tackle problems around human nutrition, animal nutrition, plastics, I hope greenhouse gases, and is truly embracing the idea of collaboration. So my biggest learning is what it takes to be CTO of the biggest company, food company in the world. An extremely impressive performance, Stefan. I'm sorry I built you up beforehand, but you over-delivered.
No. Now, thank you.
Does anyone have any questions for Stefan? There's Nicholas, I think, in the corner. Carlos, in the front. It's the founder of Flatev, the tortilla machine.
Hi, Stefan. I'm Carlos, the founder of Flatev, the Nespresso for tortillas and flatbreads. And I find very interesting what you show at the end about the innovation center like Cubic has been doing for startups. And my question to you and Nestle is, how are you planning to collaborate with startups compared to the past?
Yes, good question. Look, First of all, the question is, for us, why should we collaborate with startups? I can give you very briefly a rationale. There's a lot of inspiration which is coming from those smaller companies, which we as a big company need. And I also believe if we put the strengths of the big companies and the small companies together, it can be quite a winning formula. Because as a small startup, you need to get scale. How do you get scale the quickest if you collaborate with a big one? Now, what's not working in my mind, if big companies are asking for all the IP and all the rights up front, that we will not do. So we will probably ask, and we are still having a bit discussion, for some equity on the startup. And then we will invite the startup in our center. The startup will be able to work there 6 months. And now comes the interesting thing. We will offer all the expertise we have in the center. So this is a center of 800 scientists. So we open all our labs to the startup. We open our pilot plants, and we can pull in any expert at any time to help the startup out to advance quicker from the idea to a valid prototype. So that's, for us, a totally new way of working. In the past, we would have closed our labs and would say, everything top secret, we don't want to share, and he knows that. So we will change that now quite dramatically. It's really for us bringing open innovation to a new level, to move to real open innovation. You know, only a project which you have together with academia or with a supplier is good, but it's not a real open innovation. So we will give access to all the expertise, and that's also why we decided all these accelerators. So we will have now a big one, one of the biggest in the industry, 1,000 square meters, which we will plug into, or we are currently building in our fundamental research center, but we will build those accelerators now in each of our development centers. So finally, we talk about a huge global network. We will have one in Africa, we will have one in India, one in Singapore, and we will give startups, but also university teams and suppliers and partners access to all the expertise we have there. And that's highly attractive. So it's not only giving money and then hoping that something is happening. Now it's really to bring in all the expertise. We can even talk about marketing expertise, which is also often missing, regulatory expertise. And you, I'm sure you're facing that. If you're a startup, you have no clue about food regulation. So we can pull in our regulatory experts who can tell you in any country of the world what's the food regulation related to your value proposition. So that's pretty different.
Yeah, that's comprehensive, yeah. And an excellent example. Nicholas.
Hi, Stefan. Thank you very much for this presentation. It's Nicholas Meneses, working at Bühler Group. My question is related to what actions would you take to keep a product alive in the market? Let's say you and your team develop this great product that it makes really good for nutrition of consumers, and it's very good for environment. But let's say government or retailers or consumers do not see it yet, and you have a certain time period before pulling out this product from the market, before it doesn't make economic sense. So how do you, or what actions do you take to keep this product alive in the market?
First of all, if you do renovation, you have always a comparison. So you have to get better in terms of nutrition, but you have to get better also in terms of environmental footprint. And we have all those tools to model the environmental footprint of a product. So we can show that we are getting better. Now for innovation, I fear, finally, we have to deliver everything which I mentioned here as a base. So it's not that easy that we can say, okay, we ignore one of those components. It will maybe short-term work in a certain environment, in a certain context, because the importance of the environmental component is still different in different locations. And you all know that. If you are traveling, you see different behaviors. You see different actions. But eventually, we believe that this will raise quite quickly globally, because the problem is there, it's so visible. We have another very hot summer, so climate change is a reality. I'm not saying that this summer alone is giving the evidence. If you look at the temperature development over the last couple of decades, it's going quite quickly, this increase. And for plastic, you all know that. If you go to certain locations, we are drowning in plastic, and plastic is staying there 400 years. Carbon dioxide, by the way, 200 years. So everything which we now put out there will remain at least 200 years. So I fear we cannot just simply ignore one or the other. It's important that we bring to the market products which are better than what's already there. So you have a benchmark and you improve versus this benchmark. If you go too radical, you will not sell anything. And if you don't sell anything, well, there is no advance. But finally, we need to consider all those elements.
Very good. Yeah. Stefan, I would say thank you very much. And I would also say I love the initiative for the startups. Once you've put all your science in and they need to scale their technology, our doors will be open to them.
Absolutely.
Thank you very much, Stefan.